I work as a technical architect in one of the investment banks, and my responsibility over there is to architect data flows and build applications for debt reporting. I'm currently a student at ISB, and I'm pursuing the business analytics course over here. And my co-author is Biju. He's currently managing the logistics and supply chain at a private firm. He has some official commitments, so he couldn't make it today. So our topic is like, we actually wanted to do something which can enhance the customers traveling by vehicles like cars. So I'm actually a person who takes a cab ride for every day to my office, and the ride is not very good. Sometimes the roads are bad, and sometimes the driver is bad, and he just goes away and like in a very fast way, and then over the bumps and speed bumps and things like that, the road and the ride is not very good for us. So I wanted to see if we can do something for that, and this is how this paper actually started. So in our coursework, we were actually given a data set which had the cab data set actually with the GPS coordinates, and we were asked to come up with some business insights or some business recommendations for the cab company. To solve that, so we did the usual way of clustering, unsupervised techniques like clustering and then frequency mining, and we figured out some interesting spots in the city. But to make some business recommendations, we wanted to see something else which can be done for this space. So that's when the concerns which we saw in the case, so we wanted to address. So I'm from Chennai, and when the monsoon happens, it's always chaos. If you see the first picture, there's a flooded streets, and navigating them is really difficult. And I actually almost every time seem to catch all the potholes on the way. So second thing is like, there's a speed breaker, and it's really undisguised. And when I take my car and ride it, I actually I've ended up many times going on it at a higher speed and then applying hard brakes. So I wanted to see if we can solve this problem as well. So that's how this actually this we started off with. So we saw what are the devices available in the car. Basically, the driver is using a mobile phone for getting the route navigations, as well as but the device is actually having multiple sensors. So it is loaded with accelerometer, magnetometer, and a gyroscope. So we thought if we can use these devices and detect these road conditions, then we can actually intimate the driver, saying that okay, there is a upcoming speed breaker or a pothole, and it can actually go at a reduced speed so that ride is better. So yeah, so we saw the data coming from these devices, and we took the device orientation events like the alpha, beta, and gamma, and we saw how the data is actually coming in. And based on that, we actually did a simple POC first to begin with. And then actually, once we started getting this results in our POC, we were convinced that, okay, like the activity tracker, how it tracks your steps in the phones, so we could also track the various conditions of the road by using these sensors. So that's when we thought we'll build up something which we can crowdsource and get the data from many friends. And we built this application. So it will collect all this data of the device orientation along with the GPS coordinates along the time. And it will upload to our server. So, and once it's uploaded on our server, we'll be performing the basic statistical techniques of cleaning the data and then performing the various marking the road conditions like potholes and speed breakers. So this is our approach. So we took the data, first level, and then we did the ingestion layer, where we did some cleaning up, as well as we enhanced the points. The GPS points were often erratic. So we enhanced those points. And then we did some statistical techniques. So we did the outlier detection on the points, which were actually outliers. Actually, the road surface is supposed to be flat, but if there is a speed bump or a pothole, there will be a spike in the readings. So we wanted to actually interested in seeing these outliers and mark those outliers for further investigation. So that's what we did. And the second thing we did is like, was an extension of what we did during the coursework. So if you have seen, if you are taking a cab ride, sometimes the cab is, the driver is very good, but the cab is inherently having some issues. So it could be an issue with the shocks, the suspension has gone bad, and they're not replacing it, or it could be something like a worn out brakes. So, and many a times I have seen this, like with the older vehicles, like in Uber or in Ola. So if you see, the older vehicles will have a lot of vibrations coming into the cabin space. So once we have this device in our cabin space also, and we got a, like, data was coming with all these inherent noises in our stream. And that's when we found actually that like it was able to capture other conditions of the vehicles as we progressed. So a typical result was like this. The first one is a car going over a speed breaker. There was an initial spike in the data, and there was a flat. And then again, when it's descending, there is again a spike in the data. And similarly, if you see when the car goes over a pothole, there is a sharp descent in the data readings. And then again, the spike happens. And when there's a lot of bad patches, you see then the vibrations will be like completely spread out over the entire region. And I actually work in Chennai, so this is my observation when I did my readings across my entry into my office. So there are four speed breakers and all the four spikes captured over there. Okay, so the second thing which I said is like the extension, like the vehicle vibrations due to bad shocks and things like that. So these were all noises coming to us, but they had interesting information and we didn't want to discard those informations. So we designed a technique. So we basically took the same class of vehicle, like let's say a Swift car, and then we took like a randomly five cars, random five Swift desired cars or something, over the same patch of road. And we did ANOVA technique, where we wanted to see the variances in this data is the same or not. If it is same, then the car has no issues, all the five cars have no issue. But if there's a variance in one of the cars, then we did the next level of testing, where we took the same car on a different patch of a road, on a different five segments like that, and then we saw how the car readings were. So if there was variation again in those readings, then the car has definitely an issue. And at that time, we also monitored the speed of the vehicle. The speed of the vehicle is reducing or decreasing rapidly. It's mainly due to the ABS inducing some vibrations. If it is not, then it is basically a vehicle condition which needs to be inspected. Okay. The algorithms which we used for all these processes were outlier detection algorithms. So the first one we used is local outlier factor and local distance weight outlier factor. And the last one which we used is influential outliers. Actually, during the test, we found the influential outliers had the best results. It was able to track all the patches, even a small patch, a small pothole or a small stone placed in the track also was able to be precisely captured. So for our modeling purpose, we designed the model using this inflow model in our application. And we did most of the coding in R, and then we deployed it in our application. So what are the issues we faced is like the GPS. The GPS actually had given some incorrect points. It was pointing to some buildings, it was pointing to some trees in the roads, and it was not perfect. So we had to use the Google Maps API, and snap to roads feature was there. So we were able to snap those points onto the road. But at the same time, we lost some of the data because at that time the road exact point of the pothole was actually lost. But over a period of time, we were able to see that there were many data coming in. So we were able to accurately mark those points later point of time. But initially, we lost some data in the GPS giving incorrect results. And second thing is crowdsourcing. So since we relied on crowdsourcing, the vehicle has only one time it has run over this pothole or a speed breaker, and there were no much traffic going over that road, so it was actually difficult for us to mark those. So it's one of the limitations of our approach. And second limitation is like on the technical front. So the vibrations induced by the vehicle conditions like suspensions, right, we need to have a data which could be like completely isolated. So we need to have the treatment data where we could get the real world data as well as compare it with the ideal world data and see if it is related to suspension or is it related to the brakes or is it something else? So we need to have the stack data and we are working on it. So for this, for one of the conditions, what we did is like we took our car, which was due for a wheel alignment, and then we took the car on a ride for multiple tracks, and we took the readings of the car, and then we went for the alignment. Again, we took the car on the same patch of roads and saw the readings. And actually, we were able to clearly distinguish the readings before and after. So similar concept could be done for other conditions like the shocks, or it could be done even for the air pressure in the vehicles, the tire pressure, or the worn out tires also, we can actually monitor and see. And there was also interaction effort, where the car is having multiple issues, and the data was giving multiple things, and we were not able to clearly tell which issue is causing this particular condition. So these are the things which we had found out. And the next thing what we are doing is like, we are trying to come up with something like a personal activity tracker, like the vehicles. So it will actually track your vehicle from the day one, and then it will actually give you the like a real-time notification saying something is going on in your vehicle, please check the vehicle, something like that. It will give you a notification. And second thing is like the electric cars. So with mechanical cars, there are multiple things which can induce vibrations, like engines, clutches, and the bad drivers, like they are releasing the clutch very fast and things like that. But in electric cars, these variables have gone. So if you see the data is more cleaner. So we wanted to see if we can put this model in the electric cars and see how it actually improves the ride experience for the cab persons as well as the riders. Okay, any questions?
Wondering if you're taking into account a certain example. What I've observed, can you hear me?
Yeah.
What I've observed more often is that I react to the drivers who are driving in front of me more than I can, you know, see a speed bump, especially in a situation where I'm driving at 30 kmph and I have to slow down, and it's not a completely clear road.
Okay.
Are you able to predict which path the driver has to take based on the reactions of the, you know, drivers in front of them? Is that something that you're targeting? Or
no, actually the app will tell you before, like let's say you are driving on a highway or something, and there's a pothole coming in, okay? So the app will tell you before 50 meters, there's a pothole on the way, so you can slow down the vehicle. It will give you a warning message. It will be a pop-up on your app.
Okay, so it's more just looking at your immediate drivers and, you know, like self-detection.
It's not, it's like the previous drivers, how they reacted to a particular spot. So it will be learned, the algorithm is basically learning all those readings and seeing what is going on over there, and it's trying to classify those things as road conditions, like the speed breaker is there or a pothole is there and things like that. And it will give for the next rider coming in.
Is that with respect to the time of day?
No, it's in respect of time of day.
Okay.
Yeah, anytime.
Computer vision or a camera to do some inference there itself to find out whether it is a bump or is there is something obstructing, and this person has to apply brakes, and you would get much cleaner data with that one, right?
Yeah.
Why did you not actually choose computer vision?
Yeah, we saw the literature, what is being done in that space, and we see some of the works being done in that space as well using the computer vision. But there is a lot of things going on. You need a specific device for that, and there is a problem where there's shades coming in. So that's where the limitations in those work we saw. But this is a passive way of doing it. So you don't have to do anything specific for this. You just use the same device in the car, and it gives the same information. Notification is there for you. So it's much easy to market now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because the car already has rear view camera, okay, if you can use that one in a different way.
Yeah.
Identify these bumps.
Can you speak on the mic? I can't hear.
Yeah, what I'm saying is the car already has a rear view camera, mm-hmm. Okay, and if you can use it to identify those bumps in a different way, in some way, or rather if you can activate to get that data as well, we would get a better data on this perspective, my opinion.
I think we'll get the feedback. So we didn't do that, but we did the passive way of finding the spots. So
thank you.
Yeah. So I have a couple of questions. One is how you observe alphas and betas through the mobile device.
Okay. So in the mobiles, there's a web API, so which gives you device orientation events. And you can actually capture those events in your mobile itself. It actually gives you at each point what is the orientation of the device. Suppose you're having your mobile phone straight in your palm, and if you start working on it, the readings will actually start varying because you're moving the device along with your movement. So the readings will actually start changing. And those changings is actually what is being used by the personal tracking, like the activity tracker, like the steps, how much you take and things like that, right? A similar concept, the same thing, same data. We have used it for the continuous space and then model this.
And okay, thank you. How you make sure the control data, what you have for the travel cars, yeah, right? How control is the control and how's the treatment group was? How you differentiate between them and how they must they have variance within themselves?
Okay, so the treatment was done by us in a specific environment. So we took the car ourselves. And then we did the treatment, like the wheel alignment was not done before. So it was having a bad misaligned wheels. And then we ran it through multiple tracks. So we saw the readings, how it actually was. And then we took the car to the alignment. And then we actually came back to the same track.
That's okay. I mean, okay. I'm a bit concerned about that. For example, same sort of car running through a stretch, right, for 2 kilometers, right? How they have a variance within themselves, right?
Yeah.
Different cars, different speeds, different limits and that sort of stuff, right? How you make a variance of that also?
So we took a windowed approach. So what we did is like we took the cars exactly at 2 meters range, and then we did the readings for every 2 meters, and then we computed this outliers within this 2 meters. So when you do this for 2 meters, right, the speed variances actually it. During our analysis, we actually zeroes it out. You can actually see like multiple cars going through the same patch of road at the same speed actually will have a different, not have a different readings. It'll have the same readings, almost same readings.
Did you encounter that Google Maps for the traffic conditions also?
Did you?
I mean, do you also look for the Google Maps for the traffic conditions? I mean, how much traffic that particular stretch have?
No, we didn't look for Google Maps, yeah.
Oh, hi. Have a doubt.
Yeah.
So the potholes like can be there today and can be filled tomorrow, right? So
yeah.
How frequently are training the data so that you can get that information?
Yeah. So actually when we did the model first time, we did a batch process. So overnight the data was collected and then it was processed. But later on we like as more and more data comes in, it's easy for us to do the real-time notifications because like within a half an hour, we can just mark a location as having a pothole. And next half an hour, if it is actually filled by the government or like anybody, it could be marked as well. So it depends on the data, how much we get.
So as soon as you're getting the data, you're training it, I mean.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi. Did you try to get the ODB data from the car? Like it will be available in the car. You don't need extra device.
Which data?
Onboard.
Onboard, okay.
Yeah. So that actually gives you an insight on how the driver is driving the car, and for the personal car tracking, even that will help you out.
Yeah, actually, we were actually planning to do that, but there were some devices to get the data using Bluetooth. But for this study, we didn't do it. But we are planning to do that as well, yeah.
If you go to Mahindra City or Ford in Chennai, you may find many people doing that.
Yeah. So any other questions? Okay, thank you.